So basically what the LEAP is a vision of a justice-based transition away from fossil fuels, which people in the room, I assume, are know already. It's about, you know, rewriting some of the historic wrongs, particularly around colonization. It's about bridging the silos of different, you know, many different social movements dealing with different elements of the injustices in our world, bringing that together, putting forward a positive vision that can inspire people to action and strengthen the social movements that are really already mobilizing, right? And basically, things began with a gathering of representatives of different social movement groups in Toronto last May. And they had representatives, indigenous communities, labor, students, different community or organizations. And the LEAP was launched in September with a list of sort of representatives of different social movements, some sort of well-known folks like David Suzuki, to spread a message that was crafted by representatives from social movements. But basically, it was an initiative about the tagline was caring for each other and the planet, right? Quite frankly, from my standpoint, is a sort of a kind of low bar of where progressive forces should be in this country on different issues, right? It's sort of like a minimum kind of consensus position of progressive forces. It's not. It's very far from being a radical document or how it's been portrayed in the dominant media. And so there was the launch. And then there's been, you know, there's a whole series of different actions, major mobilization at the QP convention, over 1,500 people in November of last year. Then there was an international launch at the COP conference in Paris in December. Then there was a launch with LEAP Year, actions all across the country. And then the LEAP ran into a major political kind of event, which was the NDP convention in April, adopting a partial or mostly supportive of the LEAP position and calling for debating the LEAP. This wasn't just something that came on from a high. This was grassroots within the NDP, riding associations pushing this. Many, many riding associations. There was a whole bunch of organizing, actually outside of the sort of main LEAP group NDP for the LEAP had been organizing for weeks, I think into the months, of, you know, contacting riding associations across the country to get it moving within the NDP. Now, one of the things that was very interesting after the complete media freakout around the LEAP was that there was an ECOS poll, public opinion poll, of people's position on the LEAP. And it was actually amazing. Despite almost entirely critical media coverage of it, this poll shows that of the people aware, it was 40-40. 40% of Canadians supported, 40% opposed. And majorities within the Liberal NDP, fairly significant majorities, 2-1 within the NDP supporters, backing the LEAP Manifesto. One point in the LEAP is that it's called for high-speed rail powered by renewables and affordable public transit can unite every community in this country in place of more cars. So I focus more on that in place of more cars element because Bianca and I wrote a book called Stop Science, Cars and Capitalism on the Road to Economic, Social and Ecological Decay, which is a challenge to the private automobile, not at the level of individuals who are driving automobiles, but at the systemic level of a transport system organized around pushing people to drive private automobiles. It is something that we simply need to overcome. We need to end it. Like the idea of a private automobiles, with maybe some limited exceptions in kind of rural areas, is something that really shouldn't exist. That's just not, it's not plausible that 7 billion people around the world can get around in 3,000-pound metal boxes and still have a climate that's not in complete and utter catastrophe. That's just the reality. That reality is obviously very hard to implement when we see the situation in a place like Victoria and most other places in North America. We're very far from where we need to go. But the private automobile has so many elements to it that are incredibly destructive. From the fact that it's the most deadly form of mass transit, it's loud, obnoxious, disrupts communities, roads, highways, disrupt communities. It's the most costly form of mass transit there is. We spend so much money, so much of our time working to pay for these vehicles. It undermines health, our health, by putting people towards, or driving people, if you like, towards driving rather than walking, rather than biking. It leads to all kinds of physical ailments. There's incredible amount of research showing that exercise is central to healthfulness, from stopping cancer to Alzheimer's, etc. And organizing cities around the private automobile undermines that. It elicits antisocial behavior among those. You don't hear about pedestrian rage very much. You do hear a little bit about road rage. It's, of course, incredibly ecologically damaging at the level of all the different pollutants, the particulate matter. Thousands of people in Canada every year dying because of the pollution and particulate matter. The main explanation for the rise of the private automobile, and I think this is an incredibly important point that you see almost pointed out almost nowhere, it has been the leading source of capitalist profit for the past century, right? At the level of the manufacturers, the auto companies have been, over the last century, among the biggest companies in the world, making some of the biggest profits. Also, the parts makers. But beyond the cars themselves, it's all the associated industries, right? The most obvious one being oil, which is a somewhat powerful industry. The car really really was a huge boon to an oil industry that was a little bit in decline in the early 1900s. Also, from the tire companies to the asphalt companies to advertising, cars. If you pick up a newspaper, you'll find that car companies being the biggest advertisers, all kinds of advertising agencies benefiting from it. So it's precisely the automobile's role in corporate profit, in conspicuous consumption, that is what has made it the dominant form of transport. That's what it really explains. And in a context of all kinds of profit to be made under or made off of the private automobile, the public sphere is willing to plow incredible amounts of public money into the roadways, into the other things to enable that profit making by corporations and that conspicuous consumption. Another element that's in the LEAP that I thought I would touch on a little bit is it points out cuts to military spending. One of the ways it presents that as one of the ways to pay for the LEAP, right? Cuts to military spending. The first thing that should be said on that is that even if it wasn't to pay for things that are in the LEAP, we should cut military spending, right?
supporting Saudi Arabia.
Yeah. That's one thing right off the bat. First of all, the Department of National Defense is the leading emitter of greenhouse gases of any federal government agency. There's actually incredibly little on the Canadian military's ecological footprint. There's a fair bit about the U.S. military's ecological footprint, very little about the Canadian military's ecological footprint, but it is vast. When you're training on fighter jets, that is, of course, consuming a whole lot of fuel, right? And that's one of those weird ones where the training seems very wasteful to be wasting all this fuel, but you would prefer them to be wasting the fuel in training than you would be to be wasting the fuel in killing. So at all levels, it's incredibly wasteful process. There's also a whole history of Canadian bases and running roughshod on Indigenous rights, right? Under the War Measures Act, First Nations land was often seized by the military, and training missions on reserves. And this former British Army bomb disposal expert, who played a role in cleaning up Canadian bases, all the ammunition and all the different testing of bombs and stuff, had this to say, quote, "In Canada, the military acted like a giant, using Indian land like stepping stones across the country. You find an Indian nation and you find range contamination." So there's a whole history of the Canadian military's role in taking land and using it for their purpose with all kinds of massive ecological consequences. But when you come to the question of the spending and cutting the military to allocate that money to other areas, the military's budget's about $20 billion annually. If you take specific procurement initiatives, like things like ongoing one, the National Shipbuilding Procurement Strategy, that goes in at $40 billion to rebuild the Canadian naval fleet. That's the initial spending. They talking about over the two decades, $100 billion, right? I went and I looked online for a, why does Victoria not have light rail? I saw something, I didn't really search in depth, and I'm sure people in this room know much more about it, but one quote said to build 18 kilometers of light rail, they were on, on former track, they're talking about $950 million. So you're talking about that's $1 billion. You could do 100, for the cost of the naval shipbuilding program over the next two decades, you could do 100 light rail lines across the country. I would suggest that would be a better use of that money than the shipbuilding program. There's no better example of that than Canada's role in bombing Libya in 2011, right? It was a Canadian general oversaw the NATO mission. There were a number of Canadian fighter jets part of it. They basically destroyed Libya. They completely violated international law in doing it. Canada was supporting the rebels with weapons. In contravention of both the UN Security Council resolutions, there are Canadian Special Forces on the ground. In contravention of the UN Security Council resolutions, Canadian security company, Garda World, operating in Libya, again, in explicit contravention of the UN resolutions. They massively expanded what was in the UN resolution in terms of protecting civilians to be basically just to bomb the country, to oust Gaddafi, take over the country. And now Libya today is the prime launch pad for refugees into Europe. It's the place where it's been so destabilized that's where a lot of refugees are going into Europe from. The African Union was saying exactly this. The African Union opposed the NATO campaign in Libya, and they were saying this is going to destabilize the region, and that has precisely what's happened, and that of course has led to growing instability that's led to refugee crises. So it says there's no longer an excuse for building new infrastructure projects that lock us into increased extraction. Right, that's one of the things that drew the most attack from the dominant media, because it's basically saying no pipelines, whether you can refine this stuff in Canada, whether it can help some Canadian businesses, whatever. There should be no pipelines. But in fact, that should be an absolute minimum. We should be talking about the pipelines that are already built and how to start turning the tap off and you know, ripping up those pipelines, right? That's where we should actually be going. If we take climate science seriously, that's where we need to be going. But it's not just climate science. My reading of the tar sands, for instance, and the need for shutting the tar sands down is, okay, first of all, it's heavy emitting source of fuel. Okay, so that's first. And so at a climate level, it should be shut down. But it's beyond that. You know, if you go back, you dial back to 1990, when there was very little being extracted from northern Alberta. Canada was a wealthy country, right? Canada is one of the last places that should be emitting, that should be extracting new fuel sources, right? You know, people in Nigeria or other parts of the world where people are much poorer, they should come front of the line for the little bit of extraction that you know, should or will continue. They should be at the forefront from a simple justice-oriented look at climate change. It should go. Also, Canada is one of the highest emitting countries, carbon emissions per capita. So also, from a justice standpoint, we should be taking the oil carbon sources. It should be countries that have historically are responsible for very little of climate change before Canada. So from at the level of the climate science, at the level of wealth equity around the world, and at the level of carbon emissions, historic carbon emissions equity around the world, Canada should be, you know, at the back of the line when we talk about it. So that's it's an overwhelming argument for keeping what's in the tar sands in the ground. And so the point about not building new pipelines, again, that's a complete minimum. We should be looking at, you know, going, what do we do to get rid of some of the pipelines that are already in existence?
What do you say to people that argue that that is employment? If we cancel all these projects, what are people going to do?
The renewable energy technologies are actually far more job intensive than the fossil fuel industry,
The
fossil fuel industry is actually relatively non-labor intensive.
That's right, absolutely.
I heard Elizabeth May in an interview on the radio a few weeks ago say that the new renewable energy technologies are up to 7 times as job intensive as the fossil fuel industry. I mean, that's a straightforward response.
That's right.
I mean, pretty convincing if you ask me.
When we're dealing with the whole pipeline question, which I agree is very, very important, we have to make sure that we pair that with the alternatives and the need for the training and all that. Because when I think about the Trump thing, that part of that whole reason that those people voted was because the trade agreements, when we tried to stop the trade agreements with NAFTA at the beginning, there wasn't enough talk about how people were going to, the workers were going to be affected, and enough talk about how to protect the workers. And therefore, people felt like they were totally abandoned, which is what's happening with some of the workers now. So, with this question, so we really have to talk about retraining, we have to talk about putting money into that, mm-hmm. into jobs that are going to be for the people.
And when we start talking, well, we can expand healthcare and education and gain some jobs there, even though we lose some in the oil and gas industry, it's at a very abstract level. And I think on an emotive level, a lot of oil and gas workers are saying, that's great, but I don't know how to be a nurse. I don't know how to be a teacher. That's a job for someone. It's not a job for me. And I think you're right, when we're talking about skills training and whatnot, it needs to be something you can say to someone who really is about to lose their job, and not just at a macroeconomic level.
Teaching is another area, right? There's not a lot of profit to be made from that. Teaching money goes into the labor of people doing that. Part of why the oil industry is so popular with capitalism is because it's incredibly, you know, it's capital intensive, and there's immense profits that come with that. There isn't that much work. So you have to go look at a little bit deeper of, you know, what those forces, and those who argue for jobs right? In the case of, you know, the business sector, they're, you know, they're not really arguing about it. They're arguing for profits, of course, right?
So I'm just wondering, given the, you allude to the fact that we really have to, that the manifesto is the absolute minimum, but if we're going to ratchet it up to something akin to the conscription of World War II in this country, a lot of it was dependent on the dominant media saturating us with the need to sign up and walk off and fight the capitalist war in World War II, but a little less so because it was perceived as a just war in World War II. But I'm wondering whether or not the just war argument is one that can be applied to the LEAP Manifesto.
So, but yeah, I think that at the big picture level, we need to understand the crisis that we're facing, which and the mass mobilization. But unfortunately, you know, the power sources in society that were willing to accede to the nationalism and accede to the war jingoism, be it in the case of World War II for ultimately a just war, but still, you know, sort of war jingoism, nationalist war jingoism, that's just those forces are not aligned. On the climate crisis, that's not, you know, where we're at. So that just makes the, you know, necessity of the grassroots mobilizing and organizing that much more important.
Justifying the just war, doesn't it justify also the expenditure of military?
Well, during World War II, yeah. I mean, during World War II, it's a concrete thing. I would, you know, there were war crimes that Canadians committed during World War II. So I'm not arguing for everything that happened in World War II and being justified. But I think that the societal mobilization for World War II and you know, the diverting of car manufacturing to making tanks was justifiable, right? Because the fight itself was a worthwhile fight that in that moment of time needed to happen.
Manifesto is a great document, but a lot of it is abstract and longer term and aimed at the general population. So I think we've got to find some ways to deepen that discussion within the NDP.
I think there is a place for armed struggle. I don't think we're in that place of armed struggle, right? But I think from the standpoint of tactics, what's inspiring is the people who shut down a bunch of the pipelines, whatever it was, three weeks ago, and put themselves in a situation of potentially being, having major consequences on at a personal level, and just saying that, you know, this crisis is so serious, you know, we have to take serious measures like that. So I'm a strong believer that, you know, direct actions and...
There's a lot of green jobs talk within unions, but there's a real lack of action, and it's because they see themselves as seeing that they defend workers in the jobs that they have. They're not necessarily job creators, and I would like to see that change.
Now, the LEAP Manifesto doesn't call for public ownership, but the logic of the LEAP Manifesto points in that direction, because if any of the demands of the LEAP Manifesto were to be satisfied, if you had a government, for example, that was pledged, that was committed to implementing the proposals in the LEAP Manifesto, it would be immediately met by a capital strike, and you'd get an exodus of private capital out of the country, and particularly in the fossil fuels industry. And the only response to that would be the takeover of the energy industry by a government committed to the LEAP Manifesto. Public ownership in itself isn't enough. You have to have a government with the will and the ability to implement those proposals. It's a common misunderstanding that socialism comes about through good ideas and a correct program. Actually, socialism often comes about when a reform government gets into power and tries to implement reforms and is blocked and stymied at every step by capitalist interests. and by a capital strike. If you look at the history of revolutions in Russia, in China, in Cuba, in Nicaragua, they didn't go in initially saying we need a socialist revolution. They said we just want to implement these reforms. There was a capital strike, and they were forced to take over these industries, otherwise these industries wouldn't function. There would be a similar process here if you had forces committed to the LEAP Manifesto taking over the government. I don't think it should be the responsibility of unions or of any of the mass organizations to provide funds to implement these proposals. That's what we have governments for. That's what we have state power for.
Central in all this is that activism that's not much different than the activism that was needed 100 years ago of talking to people, of organizing meetings, organizing demonstrations, postering, leafleting, blah, blah. So I think that, you know, the LEAP Manifesto does provide somewhat of a partial vision of what we need in terms of moving forward.
What do you think about direct democracy by referendum?
Direct democracy by referendum can be a useful process. It can also be what we see some with the ongoing electoral changes in this country. My sense is that there's part of the stalling tactic to keep the first past the post electoral system is to call for a referendum on the issue, right? So, it isn't. In principle, I think it's a positive thing, and we should massively expand the role of public participation in decision making.